Katharina Zell-Schütz is regarded as the first ever wife of a clergyman and has been a role model for many clergy spouses since. A brave, energetic, and self-assured lay theologian, she worked together with her husband for the cause of the Reformation. With deliberate acts of charity, she contributed to the welfare and social services of her church. As a woman, she was not allowed to preach, but referring to herself as a church mother and helper. She still felt in many respects as though she held an important office, acting on equal terms with other reformers and the clergy. She legitimized her role as a woman with Bible passages and led by example.
The daughter of a master joiner, Katharina Schütz, was born around the year 1497 in Strasbourg, a flourishing center for trade and commerce with about 20,000 inhabitants. She was a bright and confident girl who loved books and was a keen learner. Still a child, she developed an interest in theology. Reflecting back on her life, she would write in her later years,
"Ever since I was 10 years old, I have been a student and church mother, much given to attending sermons. I have loved and frequented the company of learned men, and I conversed much with them, not about dancing, masquerades, and worldly pleasures, but about the kingdom of God."
It was also in attending sermons that she met her later husband. Matthew Zell worked as a pastor at the Strasbourg Cathedral since 1518 and began to preach in the Lutheran spirit in 1521. Katharina was excited about the new order of service and listened attentively to Matthew's sermons while he noticed her extraordinary commitment.
In December 1523, at the age of 26, Katharina Schütz married the pastor, who was 20 years her senior. The couple was married in the cathedral by Martin Bucer, one of the most eminent theologians of the Protestant Reformation and the first major reformer in Strasbourg and the Alsatian region. This was almost 2 years before the marriage of Martin Luther and Katharina von Bora, and while clerical marriage was still a scandal in the eyes of many, it did allow the warm-hearted Katharina to pursue her vocational interests and pave the way for a new role for women. And Katharina Zell stood by her husband, energetically and confidently, defending him in her apologia for Master Matthew Zell against the defamation he faced for his decision to marry her. For their union did cause a big stir, and in April of 1524, the Bishop of Strasbourg excommunicated Matthew Zell along with 6 other newly married clergymen. By means of a papal anathema, they were eventually excluded from the community of the church. This prompted Matthew and Katharina Zell to commit themselves all the more resolutely to the reformist movement, for which the free imperial city of Strasbourg would become an important centre. Her justification of clerical marriage in defence of her husband was the first time Katharina Zell became a public figure. In her apology, she attacked the double standards of the priests who were supposed to be celibate but often kept concubines. In stressing that Matthew Zell was her loving husband and she his loving wife, she wrote that they have never had a quarter of an hour when we have not been at one.
Katharina Zell simply ignored any conventions she deemed wrong, and she didn't think much of Paul's verdict that women should be silent in church. In fact, she had a clever point to make against it.
Paul told women to be silent in church. I would remind you of the word of this same apostle that in Christ there is no longer male nor female, and of the prophecy of Joel. I will pour forth my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters will prophesy. And you know also that Zechariah became dumb so that Elizabeth blessed the Virgin Mary.
It was only the second published work of this courageous woman, who was a skilled writer and whose reasoning suggested an intimate knowledge of the Bible. In the manse, where the married couple resided, young Katharina Zell devoted herself to a range of different activities. She hosted dozens of people in need of help for weeks on end, starting in the summer of 1524 with asylum seekers from nearby Kensingen, where 150 townspeople were evicted for their evangelical beliefs, followed by refugees from the Bloody Peasants' War in 1525. She wrote a widely read letter of consolation to the suffering believers in Christ, the women of the congregation at Kensingen, whose husbands had been forced to leave and find refuge in Strasbourg. In this letter, Katharina Zell reminded them of the sufferings of Christ and made reference to a verse in Isaiah.
Just as a mother cannot forget her nursing child, neither shall the Lord forget you, thus pointing out the feminine side of God.
The pastor's wife took in many of the religious refugees who were beginning to flock to Strasbourg in great numbers. For others, she organized shelter in the former Franciscan monastery, and she continued to visit the sick and the captive until the very end. In 1534, she published a book of Christian songs, teachings, and prayers, followed by other writings.
Katharina Zell knew her Bible well and corresponded with many reformers, some 30 of whom were also guests at the Zell's manse, including Huldrych Zwingli from Zurich and Johannes Eco Ampadius from Basel on their way to the Marburg Colloquy in 1529, where the Lutheran and the Zwinglian branches of the Protestant movement tried to solve their dispute over the Lord's Supper. Having heard of this disagreement, Katharina sent an emphatic letter to Martin Luther, whose writings she had read at a young age, admonishing him to put the love between brothers and sisters in faith above all else.
A few years later, in 1538, she and her husband visited Luther in Wittenberg. Katharina's keen interest in the Protestant Reformation was inspired by her wish to establish a truly Christian community. When Matthew Zell died in 1548, numerous members of their congregation attended the popular preacher's funeral. His evangelical sermons at the Strasbourg Cathedral had captivated hundreds of churchgoers. After the eulogy by Martin Bucer, the pastor who had married the couple and one of their friends from the circle of Strasbourg's fellow reformers, the widow surprised the mourners by addressing them with the following words.
I ask you that you not take it the wrong way or be scandalized at me, as if I wanted now to put myself in the office of the preacher. Not at all. But it is only as the dear Mary Magdalene, who without previous design became an apostle and was commanded by the Lord himself.
Matthew Zell's death marked the end of a private and professional partnership spanning almost 25 years. Having devoted his life to spreading the gospel and advocating Christian reconciliation and tolerance of other faiths, the preacher had often spoken affectionately of his brave wife as his helper, by which he meant no less than his curate. Towards the end of her full life and already racked with illness, Katharina Zell still insisted to be carried out to the cemetery early one morning to help bury a Baptist woman to whom the clergy had denied a Christian burial. On the 5th of September 1562, this confident and courageous woman died at the age of 65. The people of Strasbourg turned out in force for the final farewell of their esteemed church mother.